Shade Tree Commission meeting, June 17th, 2015.
Very good. I'd like to call the order, the meeting of the Northampton Public Shade Tree Commission on June 17th. Welcome, everyone. I'll be chairing as Lily is traveling this week. No members of the public are present, so we will skip over the public comment period and go right to the review of the last meeting's minutes. Does everyone have a copy and has made any thoughts? They look good to me. There was one spelling correction which has already been made. Emulate instead of emulate. Done reviewing, I'll look for a motion. Is there a second?
A second.
Any further comment or thoughts? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Abstentions? Great, thank you. Later today, we are going to be joined by Henry Lappin, the chair of the Amherst Public Shade Tree Commission. I thought it'd be a good time to hear from him, and it was kind of the idea was maybe a chair exchange, and at some point we'll send Lily over across the bridge and kind of share some thoughts and ideas and hopefully learn from each other. Any time that we do have in between now when we arise, just think about some questions and thoughts that we may kind of want to pick his brain on to help us do our jobs better. In terms of the chair reports, I think very brief, just in Lily's absence, but just to remind everyone to provide feedback on that survey that was sent around. I believe we've received comments from two commissioners, but if the rest of us could send Lily thoughts on the survey, the questions, the order, the responses, and how to get the most information from that survey, that would be helpful. And take a look at the new website, made some additions, some additional links, I believe, Terry, right? So take a look at that and see, you know, I think that can be a process of growth, and we can continue to add more content to that as we get our feet under ourselves and find more useful resources.
Who do we contact, like if we have something if we have something we think would be helpful to put up there, who?
I'd probably funnel it through the chair.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And, you know, I think, you know, as Marilyn and I look at the ordinances in the other towns, we might come across some information on their websites that, you know, we would want to emulate as well. And so, you know, add those resources and populate it and get it as robust as possible. Any other questions or kind of thoughts on that? Some time set aside then today for timeline planning. I know we have some comments due to the City Council on the protection ordinance. Those, I believe, are due on the 20th. I think we can spend some time now just talking about where we are with that and if we would like to ask for an extension. Thinking about the public charrette that we've been talking about and where that fits in the timeline, sometime in perhaps September. And then looking forward to the grant application deadline for the Urban Forestry Challenge grant for the inventory. I think that's very important. So to apply sometime in September. So let's start with the comments due to the City Council on the draft tree protection ordinance. Do we feel that August 20th is a deadline that we can meet, or do we think we need some more time to review that in more of a comprehensive fashion? Sometime in between now and then, should we invite Wade to join us and talk about, you know, his role as planner and how that meshes in with our work? What are some thoughts that we all have on that?
I have a question.
Sure.
I know that you gathered them all together, and you, there's a thought that maybe a consolidation is easily readable will be forthcoming. Should this just be delayed until that happens, or is that so far out in the timeline that we don't need to think about?
Yeah. So I guess my thoughts on that is, I think there are probably four or so key areas that we need to focus on with the ordinance review to make sure things are in sync. There's, you know, I would say the majority of the ordinances are a bit more peripheral, but subdivision rules and regulations, the site planning rules and rules and regulations, and some zoning ordinance stuff is really where I believe we should be focusing in on. I think that that is possible, especially to find the areas of disconnect where they're really not talking to each other, and they're calling for different caliper measurements, or they're calling for different regulations. So I think that's really where the majority of the work that Marilyn and I will be working on will take place. That's probably more doable in the short term. So that's my non-answer to that question. Marilyn, do you have any thoughts on that?
Sorry, will you repeat the question?
Well, there's right now we're discussing this proposal for tree protection.
Yes.
And I was just asking, given that you and Todd are potentially reviewing how all the ordinances go together or don't, and perhaps coming up with a proposal, some simplified version, should this just be, can this be rolled into that, this review of the ordinance that's proposed? In other words, we're creating yet another ordinance that's not iterated. I think. I'm not sure.
I think it attempts to be integrated, but I do think there are some other areas that, you know, we've looked at that the regulations are crossing each other in the night in some aspects, and they're not all speaking to each other. So I do think to take a step back and make sure that they're all consistent, if that is the intent of the city, would make the most sense. And I think if we hone in on, you know, the site plan and some specific zoning regulations and the subdivision rules and regs in context of the new bylaw put forward, then that may be our best approach.
And an example of non-integration is, I didn't read in preparation for this meeting, but as I remember, there is not in particular an enforcement or a penalty in the ordinance for non-compliance.
Well, so enforcement is largely outside of the scope of anything that we can do other than public shade tree enforcement, zoning enforcement, subdivision rule and enforcement. Right. That's kind of above what I think we would be working on. Mm-hmm. What I think we need to concentrate on is making sure that the tree protection section of the ordinances themselves speak to each other in terms of the regulations and the specifics that they're asking for.
Because in the overall ordinance, somewhere there is some sort of
enforcement is largely a thing of state legislation that authorizes an agent to.
I'm sorry, no, I
don't. Oh no, just in reviewing all the ordinances, the approach that we've been taking is, you know, see what's there, see where there's overlap, see where what's missing, and then see how this fits in. So I don't have an issue with adding a new one as long as there's a gap where it would really be necessitated. But we're still sort of sifting through all those documents.
So I guess I need a clarification. When it says comments due to city council on draft tree protection ordinance. So if we say, okay, August 20th, we'll give them comments. I don't like this document at all. So, I mean, there's hardiness zones that are incorrect. There's like, you know, some things in here that, you know, I just don't think it's, the issue of meshing is one thing, So I guess I'm confused, what does it mean to give them comments? Does that, we give our comments and then they have permission, they think, okay, the council says, okay, we're ready to move, let's, you know, have this be the tree ordinance?
So our comments are advisory.
Right, correct.
To the city council, and they're due, I believe, on the 20th. So I think the decision before us are, can we issue comments that make sense and drive the dialogue forward? Even if those comments say, you know, we think we should all take a step back and look at this more holistically. I mean, maybe that is the breadth of our comments.
Okay.
Or do we ask for an extension to do the work of that collaboration, work with the planning department?
Okay.
And maybe, you know, that's what I'd say, maybe reach out to the planning department and say, do we want to take a step back and kind of do this outside of the scope of this review process now that we exist?
Okay.
And make sure that the tree rules and regulations make sync across the different structures.
Right, because I wasn't clear, I thought in my mind we would, as our final suggestion, we would actually give them a document saying, hey, this is, we think this is what should be the tree ordinance.
How about if we post the ordinance on Drive or a format where we can all access it and start comment section?
I like that idea.
That way we can be compiling all our feedback. And then if it's really like, wow, this really needs to be rewritten, then we can use that to rewrite. So perhaps on the 20th of August, we can not only compile our comments, but also suggest a document based on our feedback, a revised document.
Well, I think each one, can you give this a Word format?
Yeah.
And each one of you can make comments and suggestions, and then forward your individual comments to the chairperson. Don't forward them to other individuals, just for
because we can't have it on.
Right. So two of you could talk, three of you could talk to each other about it, but once you send, as a group, you send it all to Lily or Todd, for example, then it would violate that. But I like that idea, because then, I think one of the things that I find that I would struggle with as I look through all these ordinances is that it's all like a patchwork. And that's part of the problem, is that it only addresses a particular part of the zoning ordinances. It doesn't really address everything that we need to have, and that's part of the problem. So I think two ways you could do it is you could actually just give your comments to the City Council Ordinance Committee and let them make the effective changes, and then continue the work of actually examining all these other ordinances and then drafting a larger tree ordinance based upon the information that's in here, but still having this in the system. I mean, I think that's part of the other problem is that this is just a patch for a whole bunch of other ordinances that are in there. And you're right, it's incorrect. And the other stuff that's in here is incorrect. So correct what's in this document, because this is now going to be voted upon, so this is correct. And then continue to work in here and correct the other things in here that need to be improved upon, and present a whole document to the City Council as proposed recommended changes or proposed tree ordinance that encompasses all this stuff plus this.
Okay, so there is like a pot, because I was just worried, yeah. Like I see a big chance here to have this really good forward thinking tree ordinance.
The other thing
you
do too is you as a group, you can vote to say that I don't want to have, I don't like this ordinance. We're not going to, the vote that we're going to take on is that you don't do anything with this ordinance, and you allow us, to put our thinking caps on and make a larger, comprehensive ordinance that allows us to examine everything that you have for zoning, and then we will come forward with a larger ordinance. So don't do anything with this at this point, because I feel this is kind of just a stopgap measure for things that are missing in here, and I think there needs to be a much larger, broader look at what's really missing, and then actually put something together that does include some of the things that are good about this,
yeah.
And then some things that are bad about it. But it's a lot of work, because every time there's an ordinance, it's just like sign ordinance. Every time a sign ordinance happens, it just changes some other piece of the puzzle, and you have all these other things that don't make sense. I mean,
right.
It's just...
Yep.
Don't get me going on the sign ordinance, though.
Well, Yeah, I'm not going to go there because I can give you an example. You probably pull the rest of your hair off that you have. I am going there myself. It's coming out. So I mean, you could just change what you think and then forward it any way you like. Or you could say that we're not going to vote on this. And the reason why is because we recommend that we have a comprehensive look at all the ordinances pertaining to zoning. And we don't feel comfortable just adding this patch in this, at this particular time.
Can I ask a question about ordinances? Let's just say we do the good work of creating a substantial new public safety ordinance. Can we then vote or propose that other ordinances that are just not so good, can they be removed?
Yeah, what you have to do is you have to have two councilors basically support your ordinance changes. And
okay.
They bring it to the council floor, and the council will vote yay or nay, and then it would be referred to ordinance committee.
So we can both add as well as remove ordinances? Yep. Okay.
Yeah, obviously you have to have the factual information to back up why you want to change your ordinances. Uh-huh. Obviously, you know, modeling this community or that community, and then drawing from all those places and making a really good solid poetry ordinance.
I think that, just one point I want to make. I think in terms of the public shade tree ordinance that the city can take action on, that's really outside of the scope of
this,
the ordinance that we're talking about today. So I think, you know, we may want to have a decision on when we want to put forward and find sponsors for a public shade tree protection ordinance under the current state law that the city can act on. And at the same time, maybe reach out to the planning department and Wayne and form a collaboration with them, because we're quickly getting into a very murky area of zoning and subdivision rules and regs, for which we really have no true authority. So I definitely want to be working with them to make sure to express our concern and then find a way that collectively we can work and do a review of that. While I think we can have a strong voice in that, I don't want to take that on as kind of the official business of the commission. I think we should, you know, invite the planning department to meet with us and kind of talk about the intent of that, and then perhaps find a way forward to turn that into something more comprehensive, but on a parallel and separate track, decide when to work on a shade tree protection ordinance that would, you know, get some teeth behind some of the protection and enforcement measures that we've been frustrated by already.
Yeah, it is two different things. I mean, in order to make this work and actually get some of these things in there, you might want to go ahead and just make your recommended changes and send a proposal to the city council on the 20th, and then possibly concentrate on just actually making a local public shade tree ordinance that protects trees that is separate, like cuts, and is separate from this whole murkiness that's in here in the planning and things. Because really, our mission is to maintain and protect the public shade trees that we have. Even though I know this ordinance protects trees that are not in the public right of way, this ordinance protects trees that are on private property that are going to be removed for building, different types of structures.
This one, the draft one.
Yes, this has nothing really to do with any public shade trees at all.
Oh.
So the public shade tree ordinance, I mean, there's things in here like drip line, significant trees. I mean, all these things can be mentioned in a local public ordinance that we have just for public shade trees and on the public right of way. But this has to do with zoning. This really references 350-21, which is all zoning ordinances, or zoning code, really.
Hmm.
So that's, I think you're on the right track in your thinking. I think that's, you can get really bogged down. You know, it's like having two different missions. You're like having a mission for making a local ordinance that supplements Chapter 87, which I can enforce, and then it's also talking about making and addressing all these ordinances for zoning that would actually protect private trees.
So this is for construction events?
Yes.
Now would that also include, let's say somebody's going to build like a big box store down the end of King Street or something. And I know there's, is, I'm sure there's, on the planning zoning, there's certain amount of trees per parking places, for example. But pretty consistently, those tree areas, the rooting volume is not large enough for the trees that are in it. And that's like a simple mathematical calculation. So is that milieu in this, or would it be the public trade? Because I kind of have a...
It would be in this.
It would be in that, where design guidelines for specific...
Because I really have like strong, one of the reasons why I wanted to be on this commission was to start like using the newer technology or, you know, for instead of keep putting these trees in tree pits and, you know, these tiny little pieces of parking lot.
For a quick example, like on, I know I don't want to get too far into this, but on page 2 in E, it says that any person removing a significant tree that is subject to this section shall satisfy either of the following conditions, provided for replacement trees in accordance with the following standards. Well, if they're going to be doing this, and it's going to be a possibly public shade tree, one of the things that could be in here, we talk about structural soil.
Right,
because structural soil would be, you know, in any kind of parking lot situation, if you look right out the window out here, in this little Hampton Avenue parking lot right here, there's 2 10- or 12-inch sycamore trees that are dying because the compaction has just gotten them. But those are the kind of specific things that you can actually, those are the kind of things that we have to have a dialogue with the planning board, because those things they need to have in the site plan review that they have, and make sure that all those things are tucked in there, so that when people are doing this kind of work and they're replacing trees, that they're replacing with the proper type of soil. So they do have a fighting chance. So they last 25 years instead of lasting 3 years, because the soil they use is terrible, or it's in the middle of a heat island. So that's just an example, but there's definitely two separate things to concentrate on. The best thing in my opinion to do is give your comments about this to the city council, correct the things you think that are wrong, and have them move forward. And then wherever the chair directs you to go, which I think she wants to make a local public shade tree ordinance, that will supplement chapter 87, that would be a totally separate subject.
All right, I misunderstood that. Thank you for clarification.
Okay. So do we have general support to invite the planning department here and just get a sense of... I don't know.
I was trying to dig.
I was thinking about that one.
I think she reached out to me.
So I do want to be, you know, I do want to work in collaboration with the planning department, see how we can most benefit their work. Because at the end of the day, Wayne's going to be the one writing this. So we can confirm if we have reached out, and if we haven't, we will, and if we have, we'll attempt to confirm a date between, you know, the next couple meetings.
We're looking to review. Our role is really advisory to the planning board.
To the city council.
Well, is that right? Or is it really the
actually your role is advisory to the mayor.
The mayor. No, I mean in relation just to this one the planning commission is going to write the ordinance.
Well, it's already been written by Wayne. So and then it was sponsored by 2 city councilors. So now it's in review. Now our mission is to write a letter of some advisory to the city council.
Okay. I isn't speaking of this review. All the ordinances that relate to trees and brought them all up. Those ordinances, for the most part, fall either in planning, building, or other places. So the role of this commission is to advise those departments. Is that right?
Unofficially.
Unofficially, yes. I mean, you could say through the mayor, you know. Officially, we advise the mayor, so if you go to the mayor.
Well, I think what's happened is the ordinance was, this is probably ahead of where we wanted to be, right? Because the ordinance has come forward. They've asked for our opinion. We have to give some sort of opinion. in looking at it, we've discovered, well, this is really a possible Band-Aid on a much larger set of issues that we want to tackle. I think it's important to not tackle it on our own, but to reach out to the planning department. We've already reached out to the building commissioner, reach out to the planning department, meet with them, see how best we can work together. And if that's with the planning commissioner, or the planning board, or with the planning department, let's let them kind of show us which way would be most helpful and then move forward.
And ultimately, it's they who will bring forward these.
Correct.
That's what I'm trying to, who's actually bringing them forward. Those are the commissions.
Yep.
I was referring to us as advising them or working with them.
So on May 21st, Lily reached out to Wayne and asked him if he would be interested in meeting July 8th or July 15th. And I don't think there was a response that I was CC'd on, so I don't know if he's going to be available or not.
I could reach out if I'm reaching out to him.
Sure, yep.
You want me to forward this email? This came most of you, so you see it.
Sure, thank you. And if you also would forward a Word document of the ordinance and everyone compile thoughts and, you know, kind of track changes and do, you know, do comments on the definition section or what have you, and forward them directly to Billy. Anything else on the ordinance review for now? The next date on kind of the planning was the public charrette on public shade trees. Sometime in September. We're feeling that that's realistic and a good target at this point.
A good time of year. People are kind of back after the summer vacation and feeling fresh, and a lot of things are starting up. Were we going to do it during a meeting or on a separate occasion? It could be.
Yeah. Talk about it, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, not doing it at 4 o'clock during the work day would probably be okay, positive, but some people might really, really want to come, really, really not be able to.
I would agree with that. If it's going to be a true public charrette on shade trees in Northampton, it should be,
after 5 or
It could be 6:30 or so, something like that. So we'll just we're going to stick with let's just call it mid-September. Get past Labor Day and talk about a 6:30 meeting, and
we're meeting on September 2nd and 16th. So
I probably say right after the sometime after the 16th. Give us two meetings of solid prep of that month, and then kind of sometime whatever that week is, the end of that week or early next.
Okay. Yeah.
And hoping I'm not in Italy.
Where?
Italy.
Wow. We can meet there. We can meet there.
All right, so moving on then to the grant application. Richard, do you know anything about this grant? The Urban Forestry Challenge grant for the tree inventory?
No, I know that there used to be two rounds of grants a year, and now there's only one round of grants a year. Basically, it's a matching grant. So what I'm working on is I'm waiting to get an RFP. I met with him yesterday at Casey a couple of times. He's a tree urban forester in the city of Springfield. So he is going to send me a copy of the RFP that they use. They had Davy Tree do a complete tree inventory back in 2004 and 2005, and so he is going to send me an RFP to kind of give me an pad as to what it looks like. And then we will have to basically put the RFP together based upon what we would like to have for a public shade tree inventory in the city. And then we will put it out on the street, and then we will get back and we'll figure out how much it would cost. And then we would utilize the monies that we have in our budget of $40,000, start July 1st, and utilize that money plus we would, it's obviously going to be over $40,000, I believe, probably more in the range of $60,000, $70,000 in this town. And then we would have to ask DCR for the monies for that, to match that. So we would have to put matching monies towards it.
So my understanding, the match was also in-kind services, not just dollars to them?
But if we're going to end up having a professional use to do the work, there really won't be much in-kind services here unless we do some of the, if we were to do a public, our own inventory with volunteers, then that would be the, more likely the in-kind services than the match.
And Amherst also pursued the grant, correct?
Amherst did pursue the grant, and they used AV Tree as well. So I'm waiting for some information on our RFPs to start that ball rolling.
All right, and I'm confused by our agenda says the intent to apply due September 1st, but the date on it is November 1st. Do we know what the application date is?
I think it's November. Is that the, and Molly Frylich is the one who runs it. She'll give us a lot of help, and Dave Maloney, our UMass, has also been very involved in Springfield and Amherst. Going, I'm sure he can give us a lot of help. Have Andrew come here to park that bridge?
Yes.
He's done that for the city of Florida?
I don't know if he did that grant, but he did express interest in grant writing in general. I couldn't speak as to exactly what grant he wrote.
How much is this grant for?
What was the question?
This Urban Forestry Challenge grant, how much is it for?
I think it can be up to $50,000. Maybe it's $30,000. I think I remember $30,000. It can be as little as just a few thousand. I mean,
it's a range, but
it's a range.
Goes up to $30,000.
I think that's what Molly said.
Yeah. And that would be in addition to what the city already has allowed us?
We would have to match whatever they do.
So the funds, we are maximum to come out of tree funds. Mm-hmm. So it would limit what else we could do, depending on how much, for that year.
So do we need, Molly or someone to kind of give us a debriefing on this? Do we need more information? Do we feel like we have what we need to move forward with it?
We can contact Molly and find out what she would recommend.
Okay. Yeah, I feel a little bit in the dark on that one. It could be just me, but if we had a stronger sense of how to make our application as strong as possible, that'd be good idea.
So I pulled this up on the website. There's a couple of eligible groups include all units of local government, nonprofits, 501c's, tree organizations, local tree departments, citizen tree groups, and specifically encouraged to apply. Tree inventories and analysis, resource assessment, and then trying to see if they have some details there. I didn't see that. As part of the grant, because we can't ask for the grant without having knowledge of how much is
And is it important to demonstrate need, to kind of have facts about just how bad things are, or is that irrelevant?
If you don't have a tree inventory, that would be the need.
That's it? Okay.
That's been a pretty proven grant award for a lot of communities utilizing that money for tree inventory, so I think that would be probably one of the better drivers we could have, I think, just to start with.
All right, good. So reach out to Molly and see, get some additional information, and especially the clarification on the due date. And we might need to internally reach consensus on if we can do this internally, writing it, that is, or if we're going to need staff assistance. Any other thoughts on the grant? Then the last was kind of 100 street trees planted during the fall by December 1st.
To be planted?
That was the stated goal on the agenda. So, but that might blend into more of the tree warden's report in terms of how we're looking with the current fiscal year budget and how we're looking next year. So,
I've been working on this with Jay to at least find out what's available. I expect to hear back from three nurseries probably by Friday and Monday. And I think once we've heard back, then it should be possible to, if we hear back things that are good and usable, it should be possible.
I sent an email to Jay and Rob and reached out and asked them if they would assist me because of the time frame and the time crunch, if they could actually contact some local nurseries to see what they have for stock available based upon the old list that we used for the tree committees list that was updated in 2012 for street tree plantings and any additions that they may have. And what I think that what I framed in the email was the best thing would be to buy blocks of certain species and basically get them invoiced out so I could have actual invoice to submit prior to June 30th or on June 30th with the invoice trees, and then we need to make sure that the nursery those trees are available to us, or we wouldn't take delivery until the fall.
You did say to the fall, I didn't say when fall.
So when you have, I guess what I'm looking for is a recommended list of trees from what nursery, and then I can make the official communication with them to actually get an invoice made, and then we can submit the invoice to the mayor's office. We basically have a credit for these nurseries.
So are you looking for something from us prior to the end of the fiscal?
Yes.
So by June 30th?
Before then.
Yeah.
So if Rob is going to be getting some phone calls back, or Jay, by the end of this week, that would be really good because it would give me a week's turnaround time to work with Terry to make some documentation that's requesting, 10 of this species, 10 of that species. And then what we'll do is we'll tailor the species to the locations that we have staked out. There's not enough time really for me to go out and stake all these locations in a week and figure out what's going to go where. So if we have the block purchase of good urban street trees that we can use in different locations, and then if we have extra trees that won't work, that are mature, that will be really mature trees, we can put them in city parks, city cemeteries, any kind of public green space. So the goal is to get 100 trees in the ground, hopefully all of them in the street.
So do you have targeted areas in mind?
Well, Lily and I had a conversation about that at
the ward center.
The little meeting we had last week with Sean Bucation. And she was interested in focusing on the gateways to the city. But my thinking is that I'm okay with that thinking, but I don't think we should just concentrate on gateways. I think we need to go back to the neighborhoods where we actually took our trees down, and I have a very long list, and actually plant trees back in the neighborhoods and try to make it make it so it's equitable across the city. Obviously, planting in Ward 6 and Ward 7 on Sylvester Road, I mean, yeah, we could probably use about five or six trees out there, but there's so many trees versus a place, you know, like off of Market Street or Elm Street or any of the places that we have lost a lot of trees. You know, I'm kind of hesitant to want to try to regreen Pleasant Street because Pleasant Street is going to
Get ripped up.
Is going to get ripped up and changed.
Yep.
King Street is, you know, like a hodgepodge mix and mess of stuff that is just, you know, I don't know what to do with King Street, to be honest with you. Kind of a loss over there. But I think it would be good to utilize the places we know where trees existed and put trees back.
And are those generally in just
They're all over the place.
All over?
Everywhere.
I mean, from my perspective, you know, I don't know if the gateways are defined or not, but certainly, you know, the village centers and around the schools and pedestrian routes, strongly used pedestrian routes around the schools and combined to, you know, where the public buildings are, you know, if there could be maybe layers of priority in terms of hitting the areas that you know to be deficient and have things recently removed and not replaced. But within that, focusing in on those areas of heavy pedestrian use or where traffic calming is appropriate from a street tree perspective. Looking at Florence Center, for example, it's a barren wasteland of no treeness. So, I mean, that needs a lot of attention.
It is. Florence Center's a good example of where, I mean, we have tree wells that are the size of this table and there's no structural soil. You have like 5 inches of topsoil and the rest is just backfill gravel. So anything you put there is a grow well. So it'd be one of those things that you would want to talk about when you look at the overall zoning ordinance about making, when there's any kind of changes, you know, structural soil has to be planted, placed in X, Y, and Z place for X, Y, and Z trees, you know, for stormwater runoff plus for the health of the tree. So, but
But in terms of, but this, the wells that are there now, it's just, you know, on Main Street, I mean, no one's going to be zoning that, you know, now that the building's done. I didn't even see any street trees put up next to the new building.
They're all going in the back.
Yeah, but, yeah, which, you know, so that's a mistake. You know, those existing wells, that's beyond zoning and that's something that, you know, we and you can go and at least attempt something because
Well, we've replaced trees. I replaced a couple last year and replaced a few the year before, but they don't seem to do very well. Unfortunately, the trees that do the best in any of that are old.
We can also
And there is a ginkgo, a couple of ginkgos.
Yeah.
A ginkgo in front of the bank.
We can also ask on our survey what trees people want planted and where.
Yep. That's also another good way to actually get some feedback from residents, you know, other than using the list that we have. Plus places we know that are deficient in trees, which can come. Downtown's going to be deficient in a few trees. There's some tree wells here that are empty. And not, like you said, downtown's not going to really change. Main Street's not going to change at all. So we have to, either we just plant the trees for the sake of planting them, or we actually make a concerted effort to actually and put some structural soil in there and actually plant trees properly, which we could do that as well. But I mean, that just takes some legwork to get a someone who is a professional installer of structural soil, which I think Jay and I had a conversation about that.
Yeah, be licensed.
In order to do that, and then you have to follow the guidelines to get the tree planted properly, so the structural soil is functioning properly. So, but yeah, there's lots of places that we could plant a lot of trees in a lot of different places. So it's not really the locations at this point. It's just getting the actual physical trees on a list so I can actually create an invoice and submit it so we can hold on to that money. So we don't have to, we're not going to lose that $20,000.
So this is our last meeting in this fiscal year. So what do you need from us today?
I don't need anything today from you. I just need to be in contact with, of course, in the lab, I need to be in contact with Bob and Jay. Just formalizing that list, and then I will work with Terry and put it all together and get some invoices.
Rich, is the list that you circulated, are those existing trees or those are potential trees as well as existing?
This list?
Yeah.
This list is recommended trees.
Recommended.
Recommended trees, which I think, have you had ever seen?
Yeah, can we get?
Yeah.
I just wanted to.
I'll send it to you electronically.
Yeah, that's fine.
I can just give them a copy. I give them one already and I have more than, that's all right.
I guess as far, I just want to put my two cents in about where put the trees. I mean, I like what you said about, you know, schools and pedestrian areas. I really would rather see, which is great, as long as the sites are going to support a tree. I really just don't think it's a great idea to keep putting trees in tree pits. And it, I think if we kind of put trees, sprinkle them throughout, you know, with some priority, I think the goodwill in the city will, you know, be raised because it's not all going to one place. But also, if people start asking, well, why aren't we putting trees in Florence? Why aren't we putting trees in Florence? Well, we have to do some sidewalk underneath the sidewalk amelioration or they're not going to survive, you know? So it would be kind of a side mission of, by not putting them there to do some education.
Right, it's not just about the tree, it's about the environment.
Yeah, yeah, they're just never going to make it.
It is discouraging to see the nine, man, look at it. So, even though, I mean, they didn't replace them, it's the process they went through.
It's a lot of money.
Yeah, it's a waste of money.
It's a huge, I mean, each of those trees is, you know, above $250 usually, right?
Why, one of the things I'm hesitant, we have, over on Armory Street, there's a whole line of ash trees there. And they're very healthy and they're mature. And I'm like reluctant, I mean, that would be, it would be smart for us to get rid of them, to be honest with you, because they're on the ash board, but I'm reluctant that, what are we going to put in this place and is it going to survive? Is it going to make it one winter? I mean, I don't know how many trees died this winter we planted last fall. I read what I planted died. They just desiccated the area. So it is very frustrating and I understand that. So I think that we need to concentrate on getting the trees planted in places we know that they're going to succeed.
Right.
You know, and then if it means we have to look at a different approach to how to do the urban areas, then that would be something we're going to have to look at.
Yeah, if we could go for grants or something like that to do a, you know, remove some panels of sidewalk, do something, you know.
Rich, is there any type of map that we can refer to where there are existing trees or the need for trees? Is there anything that, is there any kind of visual?
One way we could do that is I could give the locations that I have to Andy Keizer and he could put them on a GIS map for us. It'd be a little bit of work, but he'd probably be willing to do it.
Might be helpful just to see, oh, there's a lot over here, there's not a lot over here. I don't know the city as well, so.
Well, typically what I've done in the past is I just take the list that I have generated from all the prior renewals from the year or 2 years before and I will go to each one of those sites and I'll visit the site. Meet with the residents if they're there, if they happen to be there. If they're not there, I'm putting a stake in the ground for a dig safe, providing the site is good and I match the site with the tree. And then typically nine times out of ten, I get a phone call from the residents and I don't really want that tree there. You move it a little bit to the left. And then it precipitates me having a meeting. And then that's how we planted them all these years. So I worked off really a type list, but I can see if we can get it in a map form so you can get it kind of a broad sense. What I might also do is try to get another map that actually shows you all the removals that we've done last year, so you can actually have that as a visual too, to kind of see where we've, our largest concentration of removals have been. So,
be good. We kind of merged into your report, so.
Okay, well, that was one.
Just keep going.
That was one item. I just wanted to swing back. So you're going to be in touch with me in the next couple of days?
I'm hoping to get written responses from three nurseries.
Okay.
Which I will share with hopefully.
Okay. All right. So that would be good.
Didn't get a chance to expand the list from the list, but future.
Yeah.
You sent us that link from Cornell?
Yeah.
Yeah, I haven't had a chance to look at it.
The link wasn't on there, so I just sent it today.
And so I've already been in touch with the nurseries.
Okay.
So the tree planting was one item I wanted to talk about. Pulaski Park, I brought one blueprint, because we talked about briefly at the last meeting about the demolition plan of the mature trees that are there. So if anyone wanted to look at this, they could do so. Should have brought a couple smaller ones, that's all I have at the time. So you want to come over to Henry's and come take a look at this. So this is the demolition plan for the trees and for the benches and the playground structure. So these X's here represent trees that are going to be removed for the construction.
Where's the street?
The street is here, Academy of Music Building is right here, back parking lot, large oak, blue spruce, small hemlocks blocking this electrical, underground electrical transformer, Norway maple. These are all white pines, this is a cherry. This was that large silver maple we had to take down that fell, actually, parts of it fell off in the park, it was actually watered. This is the locust. This is the hackberry that Jay and I planted. This is another large blue spruce.
That's one of all the lights on?
That's correct, and these are the dogwoods.
And why are so many being taken down?
Because they really do not fit in with the landscape of the park and how it's going to change and the visual view. I don't know if you are familiar, we've been to any of the charrettes or see any of the final plans of the park.
There's some pictures of it.
So basically what they're doing is they're removing all of this green space that's in the front that presently can't see in the park, and they're actually making a large area of a seating area, regular cafe that you can actually see, that they're going to have large mature trees that create another canopy. So they're almost doing, putting more trees back in the park than we're removing. So I think we're moving to 17.
Where's the tree being killed?
This tree right here. So 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 at the moment. 15, 16, 17. So 15 trees altogether. These are going to get a reprieve for the time being because phase two of this project, there's no funding available for the overlook, which is basically developing this whole bank that goes back into the roundhouse parking lot. And so these white pines are going to stay. But there's no way medical has to go because they're going to reconfigure this whole area right in here. So that's what we're going to be working on the next week.
So can I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
I'm Henry Lapp.
Yes, I know. I know that.
Why are you taking out trees that are already established to put in new trees later?
That is what, because they are changing them. They're changing this whole park. Basically, this is all concrete here right now. So this is going to be a large turfed area right here with a large terrace area with stairs. Bus shelter is going to be moved up here. I wish I had brought the other plan for you. And they are going to end up having a rain garden that's going to run the length of this. It's actually kind of goes like this. It's going to be a new playground structure over here, and the majority of the mature trees, the large trees, are all going to stay, with the exception of these that are marked. These are all dogwoods in here. So the problem is that people, the way this park circulates, and the way this park is just was built in the 70s, and it's just not, it doesn't work for what the vision of the planning department and the city residents want. So the city residents actually had a tremendous amount of input into this plan. There are multiple public hearings, and there's two charrettes. A lot of public input.
When you say turfed, are you referring to grass, or will there be some type of material other than cement?
There'll be grass. There'll be permeable. This will all be permeable pavers in here.
Yeah, nice.
So there's going to be definitely a lot of attention focused on stormwater runoff. So basically, the reason why we can't keep the hackberry is because this elevation is going to change so much to run all the, basically sheet flow all the water to the rain garden that's going to be in the middle.
When does this begin?
The bid opening is the 29th of June.
So our warden has to start next week, because we have to be out of the contractor's way, because we're doing all the removals. And then the contractor will come in and provide all the tree protection, which I'll be inspecting it all to make sure it's all appropriate.
That's the question.
Yes, yep. Inside 300, section 5, I made sure that was written into the, into the bid documents, so. And then I'll do the inspections, and Stephen, Stimson and Associates is the architects, and very, very good group of folks, very conscientious, myself and Jim Law, I've met them all the time, as my man, as plus a lot of different people, so.
I'm Rob, I've been over there, it was, it's been 2 years.
Yeah, I recognize your face.
Turkish filberts? Where you live, were those filberts?
Hazelnuts, yeah.
Hazelnuts.
Turkish hazelnuts, filbert, the name is.
This just gives you a rough idea of what the concept of the front, classic part of the building.
I can think that what happened is, the way they parked this design before, there's a shallow area that kind of, people get to and they don't get any further, they don't see into the park. So the use of it is kind of bunched up right by the street, kind of very uncomfortable.
Yeah, plus they want, they're making a clay structure in the back, where it's all made out of natural, it's all natural clay material. This is gonna be a place for people to gather right here, it's gonna be having tables and chairs, it's gonna be lit. They're replacing, these were originally gonna be hawthorns, but I think they're a different species, I don't have the proposed planting plan with me.
Is that horse chestnut gonna stay out in the front there?
Yes.
Don't get it.
It will be protected. Yes, it's actually got a big bunch of birds.
It's like a terrible place.
Big bunch of tree protection around it, so. Yeah, I mean, I think there was a lot of controversy in the beginning about cutting down the Colorado boosters and all, because of what it really represents, but I think that people are, it is what it is. In order to renovate the park, in my opinion, and make it something viable for 2015 and forward, I think it's not a bad plan. And I think what we're gonna gain out of it is gonna be much greater than what we have that exists in the park, so. So if any resident happens to call you about this, you can refer them to me.
Okay.
If you'd like, that way there I can communicate with them.
Yep.
Let's see, the other item was the public shade tree hearing that we had at 7 Adair Place, May 20th. I'm gonna be meeting with the mayor on Monday to make, he's gonna make a final decision as to allow the tree to be saved or removed. So he and I are gonna do a site visit there on Monday.
Which tree are we talking about?
On 7 Adair Place, we had a public shade tree hearing on May 20th. It's 11.5 in Silver Maple, with the residents, the new residents that live, the abutters would like the tree removed because it is potentially blocking part of their driveway access, proposed driveway access.
This is the tree that's been hinged on by construction driven over.
Yes, sir, yeah. And so the residents have been, the new residents have been very nice about wanting to be completely responsible for removing the tree, and also actually replacing the tree and kind of other trees in the neighborhood. So that'll be a conversation that I will have with the mayor in writing and personally, so he'll make the decision, because there was an objection. And then the other, two other items, we are gonna have scheduled public shade tree hearing probably for July for the trees on Elm Street that are in front of the Cutter's Iskin House, as Lynn, which I talked about before, which were part of a larger conversation that I had with Jay from Smith College, and the Smith College basically did plant all the trees they said they're gonna plant in kind, that basically made up, I'd say about half, a little more than half the caliper loss, plus half the caliper loss, plus the in-kind services that Smith provided by actually providing the trees and planting them and maintaining them. So they did some beautiful separate back plantings and some elms behind them. What these lindens are, which the lindens are really, at least they're just gonna continue to get hacked at this point.
They're on Elm Street.
They're on Elm Street, right, directly underneath all the utility wires. And they're really, one of them has gotta come down, it's unhealthy at this point, and then the other ones are just, they're just a growing massive mess. So that'll be scheduled. And then there's another public safety hearing that's going to happen on Hinckley Street, which I don't have the address. I went and looked at the tree with Felix Harvey. It's going to be part of the construction project that's going to be happening on Hinckley Street. And I'll be working with Felix on that in the next couple of weeks as well. So it's like an 18-inch elm. Chinese, he's a Chinese elm. It's got a very old, the sidewalks have been boarded against it. But Felix Harvey, who was a former representative to the other tree committee, has worked really diligently on actually saving and preserving the majority of the street trees that are on that street. That's the only removal. There are some smaller removals that we're going to have to do, but this is the largest one of all. Some kind of small 1.5-2-inch trees to make room for a sidewalk on the easterly side of Hinckley Street.
Any update on the enforcement action on King?
No. No update on that. No update on the other enforcement action on 191 Spring Street. That's in the city solicitor's office.
Okay. Anything else for Richard?
Well, speaking of the Smith campus, what's going on around the big corner here by the gates? And are all those trees, do you feel, are being well protected?
I made it move that whole thing back 30 feet. They want to come 30 feet further in toward the trees. There's one tree. The other elm on the right side, as you're looking up toward College Hall, I think I've been fairly close to that tree. We had C.L. Frank come in an air spade and cut whatever roots were in there. There was nothing that too significant. It may take a bit of a hit, that tree, but we're doing all we can to preserve it. The impetus of that whole thing was to create that sidewalk by the street to be handicap accessible, and that whole crossing area on West Street to be more visible and less of a hazard. So that was the impetus of that whole thing. So we're doing all we can to preserve those trees.
Anything else? Good. Well, I'd like to move on and welcome Henry Lappin, the chair of the Amherst Public Shade Tree Committee. Thank you very much for joining us. I don't know if do you need introductions all the way around? So
I see people's names. I've met some of you. Jay, I met you before. Terry, is it here?
Yep.
Okay. So
great.
And Jennifer. Mm-hmm.
So we're new, and we're just getting our feet under us. And so we thought it'd be very valuable to have you come in and maybe provide some guidance and answer some questions that we may have on how to get started. I think, you know, there's no shortage of work that we have to do, and we are attempting to prioritize it kind of on the fly. And any guidance or suggestions that you may have for us would be well taken. And I don't know how we want to operate this, but I thought maybe you just give kind of a brief overview of some of the lessons learned that you've had, or maybe early thoughts, and then we'll open it up for some questions.
Okay, I didn't prepare anything
no,
to say.
Of course. I just hit you with that.
And had a tooth filled today also. My mouth, I think I'm talking okay, but if I'm not, let me know. My mouth feels funny. One thing I've learned from you guys is this public comment at the beginning of your agenda. That's a great idea. I think we could start doing that. I mean, some people have to come for that.
Occasionally.
Yeah. But that's sort of more invites. People do come to our meetings. Usually they call for it, not always, but then we let them talk. But to actually put it on might invite more comments. I think that's a good idea. I don't know that I have that much advice for you. Sounds like you're doing stuff. I did have a question. Do you do tree hearings as a group or site visits?
No.
Okay. So we started getting involved, so Alan Snow, our tree warden, will tell us, all right, there's going to be a tree hearing on this, and we go with him to a site visit. That's a public thing that we post. And then we know what we're talking about, so then when it comes to the tree hearing, we've seen the tree, we can make a formal recommendation, which he has now asked us to write, do in writing, you know, something stuff like that. And then we give him the formal recommendation, and then he either agrees with us or votes in for us.
What's been some of the things that you've been doing in terms of
involving the public or public outreach or kind of getting opinions or, you know, strategic plans?
The main thing I think we've been doing is just publicizing everything we do. So we do first Saturday of the month plantings and put out a press release before that. We do, you know, whatever events, you know, we do a site visit. We say, look, you know, they're going to build this park and they're going to take down these trees. You know, we're going to do a site visit. Please come, you know, share your opinions about these trees, that sort of thing. And then I've created a talk that I've done actually at the Valley Market and a few other places, the Amherst Farmers Market in the winter, just to educate people about the importance of trees and how interesting trees are. I think whatever way you can educate people and just get the word out about the importance of trees. People don't know that they absorb greenhouse gases, for instance. They don't know about all the things trees do. You guys know that, that's why we're here. And then probably the biggest thing that we're really working on is getting in at the beginning of developments. So we try to follow, it's been difficult, the woman who's handling this doesn't quite do it right, but pushing it, really just pay attention to, just go through every agenda that the select board, the planning board, sign review board has, and see if there's anything to do with trees. And then if it is, we'll show up at the meeting and say, what are you doing about the trees? Because most common thing is we have a tree hearing about it after the plans are set in stone. Like if you were to complain about those trees now, it's too late. You know? And I'm not saying you should, I'm just saying if you were to. So we hear it about Kendrick Park, which is a park on the north side of Amherst, a new park that if money becomes available, they're going to start working on. So Alan Snow came, showed us the fantasy plans, nothing formal yet. And we were able to see, well, this means you're going to cut down this whole row of trees here. So, you know, we want to say now that plan is going to have to change a bit. So right away we know what's happening, we get in early, we have an effect with the planning board and things like that.
Is there any kind of official mention of your committee in site plan review or subdivision review?
Not as such. We did just recently get on the select board's checklist. So before they sign off on a project, they have a note to check with us. So that was a big step because the development, I don't know if you know Amherst at all, there's a couple of big developments going in, one that's under construction, one that's in the courts, but probably in the field. And both affected trees, so, and we weren't asked until too late, so the select board now knows. And they want to work with us, you know, but we've, by pushing and nagging, so, you know, we've gotten to the point, yeah, okay, they remember us. Planning board's a little trickier, you know, not as friendly a relationship with them. The select board, the town manager is, you know, we work well with him. So I think that's a lot of it, is just going to meetings, meeting with people, you know, getting involved early, hearing about things that happen, and say, well, we have trees.
Larry, how has your committee informed the general public in Amherst that you exist? And do you feel like most of the population knows that the city or the town of Amherst has a public shade tree commission?
Probably not most, no. Mm-hmm. More and more people are knowing. We write a lot of letters to the editor, a lot of op-ed columns. And we get good press in both the Amherst Bulletin and sometimes in the Gazette. So I think that's the first step, is just write and write and write. There's a guy who does a blog, it's a fairly conservative blog, it's only in the Republic of Amherst, his dog. He's kind of a right-wing nut in a lot of ways, but he seems to like trees, so he publicizes us a lot to a population that we might not reach. He's a nice guy, it's funny. Opinions on our face compared to me. And then, you know, we're trying the newest thing we're working on, which hopefully is going to go through soon. It's been a project under works for a while. Is we're putting an insert in everybody's water bill that says street trees are protected by law. Before you cut down trees, make sure that you have the right to cut them down. That sort of thing. And that happened because this guy cut down 9 shade trees around his house, some of them quite big, so he could put solar collectors on his roof. Mm-hmm. And And he was like an environmentalist and think he was doing the right thing. He had no idea that first of all, the trees were protected, and second of all, how much trees would benefit him and the neighborhood. So he's supposedly working out something with Alan Snow. You know, we have a $95 per inch DBI, DBH, you know, fee that if people want to cut down a tree, they pay. We don't have a punitive thing, which I'd like to get going, but we do have, if they get permission, or if they don't, if they cut it down, they pay $95 an inch. So his fee was going to be about $15,000. I think he's going to work on something with Alan to do some in-kind replanting and things like that. Mm-hmm. Hey, do you guys have a replacement charge? If someone cuts down a tree, gets permission?
Presently, we don't have it. We don't have anything, so it's really up to the discretion of the general.
Okay, so that...
You can actually, we're going to negotiate with this couple that wants to put a tree down and send a debt to the school board for this. You negotiate it that way, but there's no actual, insurance replacement policy.
So what if they just say, I'm going to cut it down anyway?
We revert, if they end up cutting it down, we revert back to Chapter 87, which the only thing you can do is Chapter 87 is a $500 fine, or they get 6 months in prison. So without that local ordinance, we're going
to prison.
I know. without that local ordinance, which is really important, and the committee has identified that as being very important, one of the primary goals, I think, is getting that done so we have some teeth.
Yeah. And that'll also give you money for replanting. Right now, almost all the trees we plant are under the town grant for 2,000 trees, but we have about $10,000 we've collected in the past from people that have cut down trees. And when Alan Snow runs out of money, the town runs out of money for that, then we'll start using our money. And some of that money comes from gifts, some of it comes from tree replacement from the $95 per DBH.
Have you ever run a campaign, or what other mechanisms for fundraising have you employed?
We haven't, because we had, really since I've been chair, we haven't used the fund. We've used it, we put it in an orchard at the South Amherst High School. And since those weren't shade trees, we couldn't use the town money, so we used our money for that. Mostly that money's been just sitting there. So, pushing Alan to do collections on people that have cut down trees, trying to get money in. At some point, maybe we would do publicity, like we need money, do a fundraiser. We have a booth at the Sustainability Festival, try to have the farmers markets invited us to have a booth. We don't really have any good material to give out, so we're giving out other people's material. I did get a rubber stamp made that has our logo, and it's part of the J2P, so people know about it from that. But I want to have stuff that we give out, cards that say, this is the Amherst Public Safety Committee. This is what we do. Here's how you can help. And so,
that's impressive. You have a logo. Mm-hmm. You have a logo.
We have a logo. It's designed by an artist in Amherst, Nancy Hager.
If you had volunteers into the tree planting, tree, employed volunteers for your work?
Yeah, so you do the first Saturday of the month plantings. And we publicize it. We did one at another school recently, and some people from the school came. We haven't got a lot of response from other people joining us. It's nice for us to get out of the meeting and go plant some trees. And then we do a project called ANTS, which is Amherst Neighborhood Tree Stewards, which the name originally meant something else, but now it's, we choose one neighborhood every year, and they come up with a proposal to get all the neighbors together and how many trees they want. And then we do mass splits of trees in one day.
So the members of the community actually go out and help?
Yeah, but members of the community, of the neighborhood, come
community
up too.
Community and committee come together and plant trees.
So in the past few years, we've had three or four neighborhoods vying for like this year, that nobody. So it may be that Alan's program is real successful and the town's planted trees and it's less need. But,
is that a competition?
It's a competition. We vote on which one we think has the most neighborhood support and the neighborhood that most needs the trees.
Cool.
So this year we're going out searching for neighborhoods to do it, which not quite the way it should work.
In the last few years, 2,000 trees planted or 2,000 trees planted or what's
the? It was 3 years, 2,000 trees, and $600,000 bond issue for it. Alan got hired as a town employee. He used to be a volunteer tree warden, and he works for the Department of Public Works. And so he right away started buying equipment to plant the trees. He bought an auger to drill holes. He bought a new tree truck and things like that. So the first year we got a couple hundred trees in the ground. Last year we got about 600 in the ground. And this year, well, the third year was last year. We're up to about 1,100. And the 3 years was going to run out in July. So we got the town to extend the money for another year. So we probably won't get to 2,000, but 1,800 trees by the end of that.
When you get there, will you make a considerable difference in terms of the deficit of trees?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You look around, I mean, you've lost big trees and you got small trees in there, but you have trees that are not growing. So the key is going to be to make sure this is not an age class and we've got to keep planting. We can't just stop planting on 30 years like we did before.
Yeah. Is that all done with volunteer work?
No, most of it was done by Alan and him hiring interns, and he's got a couple people on the tree crew. But you know what happens, because he works at the DPW, he's also in charge of taking care of the pools and mowing the parks and taking care of the cemeteries. And then we had the ice storm and lost a bunch of trees, and instead of planting trees, he was out that spring chopping up trees and cleaning up things. And then the biggest project for him is he doesn't like to plant close to the street because, you know, there's so much construction. So they're mostly setback plantings, which means talking to the landowner. And we have lots of absentee landowners because it's a college town. So that's been a challenge too for him. And we actually were trained to go out and help him by meeting with homeowners and stuff. But I think nobody on the committee got trained actually went out and did it. So, you know, we're volunteers and we run out of time. And we're a little short. We lost a couple people who joined me. Someone new, gung-ho, joined the committee. And then her parents got sick and she left the committee. Someone else got a job and left the committee. So that's been a challenge. We still need one more person for the committee. We did have a couple of people.
In terms of equipment sharing, I don't know if that's something that would be helpful to look at, just on our regionalization approach.
Well, yeah, if you want to talk to Alan Snow, you know, when he's using any camp at this time, to show the hospital to the team.
And that auger that they have, I saw his presentation that he had at the Tree City USA Awards. It was interesting, they had a very huge auger in front of his kids, so it makes a very efficient time of doing that. Mm-hmm. Although I like that they pull by hand personally, but you can't always do that. Speed of efficiency and kind of plan X amount.
You go into downtown Florence and dig that hole by hand.
So, and then you asked, we've done some of those trees also. So the trees that we plant as a committee with the first Saturday of the month and the neighborhood planter, that goes into the 2,000 trees. But Alan's paying for the, some of them. He's drilled ahead of time.
What type of tagging are on the tree plantings?
What's that?
What type of tagging? Is there anything that identifies not only the tree,
but says something
about this big initiative?
We do have a banner. We put it up during the tree plantings. We put it up at festivals we're at. And I made a 4-foot banner because it was a little cheaper, and the 6-foot banner would have been better. But anyway, or it's a 6-foot banner. Anyway, a bigger banner would be good. And we've talked about different things, but you know, let's put a plaque right on the tree and put it on the ground in front of it. It's very expensive and difficult for it to grow. So we've bandied around. We haven't done it yet. I'd love to see something on every tree planted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The public awareness.
I don't know how to do that. I don't want to have a big piece of plastic hanging off a branch. If you come up with something, let us know.
In terms of, you guys had a nice professional tree inventory done.
Yeah.
Is that updatable kind of as you go?
Yes. So every tree we plant gets automatically put in the database. Not automatically, but Alan puts it in. And he's finishing up some streets that haven't been done. There's a couple of neighborhoods that are very like forested neighborhoods. He's not going to worried about those, but any tree that's in a street that's like in the open will be in that inventory.
Is that map available online at all?
Yes, you go to the Amherst GIS website, so Northampton Church GIS, and all those trees should be in, ideally, I don't know if it's in that system. So, for most people looking, it's a little hard to use, but I know which button to click on and then you get the trees to show up. It'll say proposed tree, planted tree, newly planted tree, and the trees. And then you can click on that and see the species.
Questions?
How did you select the 2,000 trees? Was there any type of involvement with the public, or was that by committee or Alan? Or?
When Alan or his interns go to meet with landowners, if it's a street tree, it's really in the public way. Alan will plant it and figure out what we have available, what looks good there, what best tree, right tree for the right location, that sort of thing. But if we're doing it in the setback, then we have a list of trees that's on the door tags. We can put it on someone's door saying we'd like to plant a tree. Or if we meet with them, we give them the list and they can help choose the tree. If they choose something inappropriate, Alan will tell them that, or the interns will tell them that will fit here. We have a list of the trees and then people can say, I want this tree. And then we have our website, which I manage myself, which I don't like doing. The rest of the community does, but we have access to it, so I can go in and update the websites, our meetings, our plantings, all that's on the town website. And there's a button to request the tree, which sends you to a form, and you fill out the form, and it comes to both me and down the snow. So that's been useful. So Alan gets the thing, and then he'll meet the owners and plant, but I also get a copy, so I can have someone on the committee call the homeowner up and say, did you get the tree? Often they say no because Alan's behind, so they'll nag Alan. If people request a tree, I want that to bump up on the list and get planted sooner. That hasn't always been the case with Alan. And then the other thing is we have that record of those people, and if we're doing a publicity thing, before the last secretary of the committee quit, we were sending out occasional emails to everybody who's ever got their email saying, here, here's what we're doing, come join us. Mm-hmm. I'd like to be doing that a couple times a year, send out a thing. Here's the plan for this growing season. Come join us.
Were you guys able to set aside any of the bond to purchase much smaller trees and grow them in a nursery setting, or was that not on the table?
No. Alan pretty much handles that money, in large part of money for equipment. But one thing we did do is we contracted with Amherst Nurseries to grow trees out for us. So they were growing out 10 Turkish hazelnut trees, which is my favorite street tree, and black walnuts. And I went and said, we had a perfect spot, we wanted one of the hazelnuts, and somehow he sold them all to somebody else, so I was a little annoyed about that, I don't know what happened. But because it's very hard to get Turkish hazelnuts. They're great, they're a 30-foot tall pyramidal shaped tree, they have very few bugs and diseases. They fit underneath wires because of the pyramidal shape and they don't get too tall. It can't be right under the wire, close. And they grow in a variety of habitats. So I have three in my property that produce wonderful nuts everywhere.
So,
yeah.
So for the most part, you deal with Amherst Nursery. You don't have there's not a town nursery.
No. Town, well, Hadley Garden Center donates trees to us at the end of the year that they can't sell. Mm-hmm. And we have a spot in town that we heal them in.
Uh-huh.
And then we'll plant those. And those, because the town didn't pay for them, the grant can go not just along the road.
How's Hadley feel about that?
Town Hadley?
Yeah.
We don't have a committee working on this,
Is there an effort to, or accounting of...
But I'm sure you guys could go, in the fall and say, hey, we'd like some trees too. We'd be happy to share with them. So I'm saying.
That's good. Is there accounting or tracking of percentage of individual species that are being, Because there's overall recommendations for a certain percentage of species per neighborhood, per, street per, you know what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, I know. I don't know whether we have that specific information in hand, but Alan, that's a real big thing for him and for us, or for me at least, I'm speaking for myself. You know, I want diversity. I was most happy about the orchard we put in. It's an alternative high school in Amherst. It's a town school, but it's for kids that can't really function in the main high school. Which my son went there, and they approached us. They had a couple of fruit trees. No, Alan, it was Alan's idea. He said, they have a lot of land. It's town land. Maybe we could put in some trees there. So I met with one of the head of the school, one of the teachers, and they loved the idea and they're putting in an orchard. Pawpaws, persimmons, apples, Asian pears, and raspberries. And the kids will take care of the trees. We help them plant. And they were out there. I've done pruning workshops with the kids, which left one of the trees kind of decimated, but it'll survive. They're learning it. So these kids are now going to be interested in trees. You know?
Do you have any other youth-oriented work?
Not per se. One of the tree plantings we did, we had a 4-H club join us or something like that. Yeah. So and that'd be good, actually. Yeah, that's something. Oh no, I should have contacted them again to join us for another one. Yeah. I don't have anything to say. And then we have the Sustainability Festival in April, town-wide, and we have a booth and. Done things, giving away ribs and things like that. And one guy who's new suggested we have a SD into that tree.
One person's
One person who just joined the committee, he said, why don't we have a guess the age of the tree contest? So we're going to come up with a list of trees on the Amherst Common and we'll choose a big one that has our name and we'll guess the name. I don't know if there'll be a prize or not. And oh, we did do, we used to do the, what's it called? Because fifth graders can, they talked about this at the conference. Fifth graders can do a, draw pictures of the tree, I think, it's DCR.
It is DCR, the Trees Are Our Champions, was the theme this year.
Yeah. And it's some organization, National Arbor Day Foundation, I think, and the, DCR does this thing where fifth graders design posters about the theme around trees and then there's a contest. And we sponsored that in Amherst for a couple of years, but then both the teacher who was involved and the woman from the committee who was involved, both she quit teaching and she left the committee, so we have contacts to do that. The schools seem kind of busy. But if you know people in the schools, you can go in and work with the fifth graders and design tree posters.
You do that already. We did that this year, and actually, lead school was second place statewide. I don't know who won first place. Who won first place? You get to plant a tree, and they do all kinds of different events for the school and for the fifth grade class that we're calling them. So it's a really good program. Phyllis Ryan, who was the librarian at the school, she actually worked with the kids in off class time. They were doing their library period of time, their reading time in the library, and actually did this with the kids. So it was the first year we had done in Northampton. It was only one school that participated this next year. I hope to reach out earlier. And also to Campus Hill, which also has a fifth grade class. So it's open to any fifth grade students, public or private. And it's really good. It's a good program.
Yeah. So that would be stuff that you guys on the committee could do to free him up to do it. I try to look at our work as free Alan up to just plant trees and do as much of the stuff we do the publicity, including publicizing when we're opposed to Alan, tree removal.
You gotta get that bond first.
Huh?
You gotta get that bond first.
I'm told maybe all of you just like Paul Snow for this one.
You have a city council right here. So go to the city council, say, here's some proposal. We want to plant 200 trees this year. We need money for that, or whatever it is, build it up. And we did a lot, the former chair, Hope Folius, did a lot of publicizing. We lost all these trees, we haven't planted trees for 25 years, and she really made the case.
I think we're doing that kind of a tandem, moving forward on the inventory, which we do not have, and also our protections are fairly weak and scattered throughout the zoning, so looking at the ordinance, creating the protections and the inventory, and then using that collectively, I think will be a nice start to spread the message.
And build the case, you know, write letters to the editor, you know, put up posters in town, you know. And one other thing that I've been pushing, it's gonna change. Alan Snow would put up a little poster saying this tree is gonna be removed, and you couldn't see the poster and you couldn't read the words on it, so he's now gonna use bold paper, you know, large headline, tree removal. So people see that and they're like, oh. Even with the little ones, people did see it, but I want that really visible.
The little ones look like a lost cat poster.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. So it's gonna be really big piece of paper, it's very vivid color and large letters, you know, tree removal slated. Anything you do like that, that brings people's attention. Oh, we lost this tree, you know. Otherwise, it's sort of, they disappear. I don't know if you do know Lawton. What's his name? Calvin.
Calvin Lee.
Lee.
Yes, yep.
Yeah, he comes to our meetings regularly. He's got a good relationship with Alan. He's gotten to know us. And so if he proposes a tree removal, we'll do a site visit. And, you know, you can often get a tree not removed or, you know, things like that.
What is the utility company?
Utility, yeah. I'm sorry, he's with Western Mass.
Are we the same?
Eversource.
No, we ours is Lance Wade from National Grid.
Oh, you're a National Grid. It's been really good to have, and he'll do other pruning for Alan lines in the area, so then we give him a little bit of a break. It's helping us too. Yeah, and the enhanced tree trimming thing that came through, and Martha Copley was really pushing utilities to clear branches by the trees. We wrote her a letter, and she didn't respond to it, but, you know. And we also wrote, and though, you know, we sent that out in one of our press releases, we're writing a letter to Martha Copley. Mm-hmm. This is what enhanced tree trimming means to the town. Yeah, it means you might have better electricity, and, you know, more short electricity, but at the same time, you're going to lose lots of trees, and you know, the amount of benefit you get for removing those last branches is somewhat marginal.
So did that have an effect on the trees in your town, or was it the utility decided to back off from the enhanced pruning, or?
They backed off a little bit. Calvin will say, you know, this is a main line, you've really got to protect it.
Right.
All right, this is this is just affecting four houses. We can, you know, it's not as important, so. Yeah.
She's not around anymore.
Right.
Yeah. 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 She didn't say that?
Oh. No.
Oh, okay, yeah. That was okay, so I'm dating myself. Anyway, I mean, it's a lot of pushing and, you know, a lot of people coming in front, not a lot, but people coming in front of us saying, I want to cut down this tree, I want to cut down this tree, solar, driveways. And we have a scenic road ordinance, I don't know if you have that here too, but that gives us a little more clout. So somebody wanted to put in a new driveway, cut down 11 trees, and it was a scenic road. So whereas, you know, they might have been able to get through without that, a scenic road has to go in front of the select board, and we made a capital case on this, and so, come on, you know.
There are state standards for what could be a scenic road.
Yeah. I don't know if you guys have that ordinance, but it's helped us with a few trees. So it's, you know, it's every little tool you have helps, and you're still going to lose some, but you keep planting new ones. And, yeah. So my big thing in the case of a park like this, it's, you know, if you have trees already, you build the landscape around it.
Cuts out the bag.
Yeah, and it doesn't always work. Sometimes you really do have to improve things.
Anything else for Henry? Super appreciated. That was great.
Thank you.
I'm happy to come back. Tomorrow I'm actually going to the South Hadley Tree Committee.
Oh.
They were at this conference, Tree City USA.
So South Hadley?
Yeah.
Are these?
They're fairly new also.
New.
I don't know, did I answer your question? I don't know if I'm helpful.
Yeah, no,
thank you.
Beautiful.
That's great.
Yeah, we'll send Lily your way, you can grill her at some point, and hopefully we can, you know, maybe do this every year or so and just keep learning from each other.
Please just show up at our committee meeting. We meet second Tuesday of the month, 4 to 6, 4 to 5:30. I'm short on the meetings, so people are a little happier.
Yeah, I got 20 minutes left, we're gonna start writing.
Okay, so I'll let you go. I would love to stay and listen, but I thought you'd go.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
Thanks a lot.
Sure, anytime. Do you have my email? I'll give it to everybody. It's wow@henrylappen.com, henrylappen.com. And you can also reach me from the town, the Public Safety Committee website.
Yeah, and all of our emails are on our website now as well.
Okay.
Okay, all of us.
I'll put things in big red letters on the website if it's like true to move the thing that I want to publicize. Yeah. All right, well, thanks.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Take care.
Bye.
See you.
Nice to see you.
Yeah. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Together.
Yeah.
We sometimes fight in that one, but mostly make good news.
Oh.
All right, take care.
Thank you. Great, that was fun. So much to do.
It is kind of very mind-boggling. I started to think about, like he's talking about things that take off Alan's plate. You know, Alan's job is different than my job. So it's Alan's job is more focused on groundwork. My job is focused on everything. And so in order to take the onus of burden off of me, some like what actually what Rob and Jay are working on is like huge, because it just takes that, you know, we're going to produce a document of trees that are available, then we're going to make something from this point forward. Now I have to do all the legwork. So those are the kind of things that I'm going to be looking for help with, you know, and I'm not going to be afraid to reach out to you to ask for that. Because I know that I can't do fast care if, you know, I can't do it.
Yeah,
what do you mean?
And
on that point, what I found interesting was they have a very, what I think was a pretty strong organized tree committee in Amherst, and yet every request for a tree is going through the tree warden, even though the tree warden already trained the tree committee to speak to the homeowners about the trees. So, you know, I'm not sure we'll do it, but I'm hoping we can do better if you want that. But that is that when people request a tree, it's going to be a setback plan in their yard. What Henry's saying is that, I'm forgetting the name of the tree warden.
Alan Snow.
Alan Snow fields each one of those requests and interacts with each one of those homeowners, which is like 100 or 200 a year or some large number. And that seems like a great inefficiency.
I don't know. We do allow setback plans because I modeled that after MGL 87.
Yeah.
So we have Terry worked on this form.
Right. You've got this new form.
Yep.
Which you posted.
Which I think is important because a lot of people will ask for setback plans. There are places that would cut trees down that are on this list that I have. There may be places where you can do setback planning. So I think it would be good to interact with the residents because you're basically asking them to make a commitment to maintain the tree. For 2 years, they're responsible for it, so it's not like planting a tree in the tree belt and then it dies and they call us and come back and take care of it. It's a totally different commitment. So meeting with the residents individually, I think, is probably pretty important. What it is, I agree with Rob, it's a lot of outreach and it does take a lot of work to meet with 200 residents if you're busy.
Also, with a setback planting, potentially you get a healthier tree.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, Felix said when he was on the tree committee, was always like, get them, you know, get setback plans, get promote that, even though nothing was happening.
Are setback planted trees, though, protected under any public shade tree?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
As long as they're 20 feet off the highway.
20 feet?
Yep.
Off any right? Off any, what? The right of way or the?
Well, in the MGL 87, it says, refers to everything as a highway. Doesn't say street tree, it says highway.
What do you look like?
Wait a minute, so somebody has a tree planted instead of the health strip, it's in their yard, setback planting, and then that's protected? Which is different than if they just planted a tree in their yard?
Yeah, that's correct, because you mentioned.
Because it was planted by,
The city?
The city, so you're committing to.
Okay. Within 20 feet of a public, okay.
20 feet of a public place, we're probably guessing that's 20 feet of a sidewalk on the homeowner's side. Is that?
Depends on the definition and the law and all, who knows?
I know.
Depends on the street, too.
I'll have to look at that. Public way.
Of course it depends on the street, but I'm just thinking when you're walking.
It means the right of way, which is a deeded right of way, or, you know, or they could be referring to the edge of pavement.
Right.
Right.
Anyway, we'll deal with that later.
Well, I'm already, like, homeowners are already asking me for trees, so I'm walking around.
So we gotta clarify that.
Well, yeah, I will have to clarify that, because they're saying, one person wanted the tree kind of up against their house, and I was like, it's kind of far, you know, you bring it forward.
This is your chapter 87, section 7, planting of shade trees. Cities and towns may appropriate money for the purpose of acquiring and planting shade trees in public ways. The tree warden or private organization acting with the written consent of the tree warden may plant shade trees acquired within public or private funds in a public way or deemed expedient upon adjoining land at a distance not to exceed 20 feet from the layout of such public way.
Layout, that's the.
Yep.
Layout of such public way.
Yep, for the purpose of improving, protecting, shading, or ornamenting the same, provided however that the written consent of the owner of such adjoining land shall be first obtained. So that document you have there was
To get.
A knockoff of, yes, from the Mass Tree Warden's Enforcement Handbook that they
Oh, okay.
make a lot of sample documents, and so I modeled it after that, and then added a few things to it, so.
So from a practical point of view, it will be within 20 feet. The sidewalks are usually
at the edge.
But I mean, the sidewalk would always be owned by the city also.
Well, the back, yes, and sometimes the layout is even farther than the back.
So if I don't want to get into that, I can just assume the sidewalk is.
That's correct.
So your general thing is 20 feet back from the homeowner's side of the sidewalk?
20 feet out from the roadway layout. So wherever engineering determines the layout of the road is, that's, we have 20 feet from that point going back.
And that's likely to be the edge of the sidewalk or further in.
It could be the edge of the sidewalk, it could be the edge of the curb, it could be 5 feet on the other side of the sidewalk, it all depends on what street you are.
Which street you're on, yeah, because I have a tree, yep.
So that, as long as the homeowner agrees to that document and says that they'll be responsible for the tree and care of the tree, and when they sign it, then we'll come and plant the tree.
Cool, okay. So in the long run, they are responsible for it, like if it gets really big and it has to be pruned?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that was.
And where do citizens find that information?
Citizens can find that information on our website. So we have actually a slide that connects you to that.
Yep.
Great.
But I was thinking about what Henry said. I like what he said about they have a plant a tree button.
Yeah.
I think I'd like to see if Andy, our GIS coordinator, can put that on there. That it would send them to two links to talk about how to go about getting a tree planted. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of big and bold instead of having it just in the little form section that's upright that's on the left hand side. So.
Yep.
I think that would be a good thing. So you can always make changes. Andy's really been very helpful with updating the website.
Yep.
Right, so currently this form is going to list a few other forms from the tree commission.
Great. In terms of the reports from the ordinance review, I don't think there's too much to report other than Marilyn and I will be getting together and kind of sorting through that, maybe prioritizing some work going forward. And maybe then we'll be collecting your thoughts through the chair on the ordinance before us and moving that forward for the deadline of August 20th. Anything from the volunteer engagement folks?
No.
Okay, good enough. Flying right through it. Any other business this evening? Good. Good meeting. Do I hear a motion?
Motion.
motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? We're adjourned. Thank you very much.
Thank you.